Namaste, y'all. I'm Randy Johnson, and it's a beautiful day. I am standing inside Magnolia Cemetery, which is more or less blocked off during the pandemic, although there are people here. And of course, we're trying to observe social distancing and also to make sure we don't contaminate the dead. We don't want them to die twice. I'm gonna pull this off now because I think we're safe and it makes it easier for me to talk. I wanna share with you some things that are near and dear to me. And I think that because we've been doing these video tours for a while now, when people seem to be tuning in, that we have some greater breadth of available topics. And I wanna share something with you that I normally would never have shared on a regular tour. Just wouldn't have had the time. And I also want to thank everyone who's been supporting these videos, because you folks are wonderful. We just heard a story from Fran Russell. Somebody walked up to her and started ranting and raving about how they love this. Well, I want you to know that we love doing this as much as you love watching, and we plan to continue this. Franny is going to be doing a tour of Ashley Hall sometime soon. You're locked in now, Franny. You got to do it. And that will announce the time for that. But what I want to do now is share with you some information about Magnolia Cemetery. It is unique. It was the first rural cemetery in the South. And what is a rural cemetery? A rural cemetery, try to say that fast three times. A rural cemetery is a cemetery that's out in a rural area. It's away from the city center. And that posed a problem for Charleston because of our predilection, our desire to be buried in the churchyards where we attend services downtown. But that immediately became a problem in this city as early as the late 1700s and early 1800s. There are mentions in city council minutes of concerns about the overcrowding in the downtown graveyards. Now, this went on for many, many years, and the issue of overcrowding came to a head in London. In the early 1800s, when they had a cholera outbreak, and they discovered that the cholera outbreak had been caused by very industrious men known as resurrectionists actually going into local graveyards in London and digging up the graves and disposing of the bodies any way they could to open up space in these already crowded graveyards for the newly dead. And it caused a cholera outbreak, and Parliament got involved and set up a committee to study it, and the solution was rural cemeteries. And the first one was outside of London. It was very successful. The idea spread to America. The first rural cemetery in the United States was in Boston. It's called Mount Auburn. Then it spread to Philadelphia, New York, and other major city centers. And finally, in 1849, kind of late in the game, Charleston, a group of businessmen downtown, purchased this land from the Cunnington family. This land had originally been used as a rice plantation. There are still lagoons here that relate back to that time when it was a plantation. And that house you see up there at the top of this hill, and that is a hill for Charlestonians. We get nosebleeds if we go up too far. But that house is the old mansion, the plantation house used by the Cunningtons. It was built in 1798. And they use that now as the offices for the cemetery. But in 1849, they do something radical for Charleston. They set up this rural cemetery. It was the first one out here. Others followed later, like Bethany, St. Lawrence, and a number of Jewish and African American cemeteries close by. But this was the first one. And at first, they suffered financially. They could not get anyone to buy into this idea of being buried so far outside of the city. And we're about 4 miles out. And they got so desperate that at one point they were selling plots by the square foot, trying to persuade people to buy into this idea and have their loved ones buried up here. So it almost failed as a business venture, but something intervened, something profound, something unexpected, in some ways very similar to the pandemic we're suffering now. It was called the Civil War. And as the Civil War began to last way longer than anyone had thought it would, all these dead began to mount, and they had to have a place to put them. And this became that location. And if you look right here, this is sacred ground. There are hundreds and hundreds of Confederate dead buried here. In total, there are over 2,200 Confederate burials here at Magnolia Cemetery. Some were buried here during the war. Some were buried here after the war. After the war, it came to everyone's knowledge that there was a mass grave up in Gettysburg, and a local merchant here who had made a lot of money as a blockade runner during the Civil War, a man by the name of Moses Mordecai, set up a foundation, and they sent ships up to Pennsylvania and were able to retrieve 82 bodies from the mass grave at Gettysburg and brought them down here and reinterred them here among these dead. And included in this group of Confederate soldiers are six Confederate generals. Now, what I want to do first is read you two poems. And I hope that this is well received, because I certainly don't want to bore anybody. But I want to share these with you. There are two poems. And the first one, and they're both written by the same man, Henry Timrod, who was a local poet here in Charleston. He was the poet laureate of the Confederacy. Very popular in the years leading up to the war. He was pretty much wiped off the history books and the poetry books after the war because of his association with the South and with the Confederacy and the defense of the institution of slavery. But he was, if nothing else, a patriot, and he loved his home, the South. He loved South Carolina. He was born in Charleston. He was eventually buried up at Trinity, which is in Columbia, Trinity Episcopal. I've been to his grave site, and maybe at some point, maybe we'll take a little road trip up there and share that with you as well. But Henry Timrod would otherwise have fallen into total obscurity, but for an act of plagiarism by Bob Dylan. In one of his later albums, it was discovered that Bob Dylan had taken the words from some of Henry Timrod's poems and incorporated them into some of his songs. And so Henry Timrod had experienced something of a renaissance. His statue, his bust, appears in Washington Park. And I want to read you a poem. He was commissioned to write the poem that would be read at the commemoration of the opening of this cemetery in 1849. And this is what he said. Let me get my glasses. It's a beautiful poem, and it always moves me, and I apologize ahead of time if I start to tear up. But whose was the hand that painted thee, O death, in the false aspect of a ruthless foe? Despair and sorrow waiting on thy breath. O gentle power, who could have wronged thee so? In other words, why is death painted with such a dark brush? Thou rather shouldst be crowned with fadeless flowers of lasting fragrance and celestial hue, or be thy couch amid funereal bowers, but let the stars and sunlight sparkle through. So this was a different vision of death. Henry Timrod was eliciting a feeling of positive vibes toward the idea of death. And this, of course, was written in 1849 when South Carolina was on top of its game, of course, on the backs of the enslaved. But nevertheless, the city was wealthy and was experiencing its halcyon days. And Henry Timrod goes on to say, "So, with these thoughts before us, we have fixed and beautified, O death, thy mansion here, where gloom and gladness, grave and garden mixed, make it a place to love and not to fear." So death was something, just another phase in a beautiful cycle of life. Heaven, shed thy most propitious dews around. Ye holy stars, look down with tender eyes and gild and guard and consecrate the ground where we may rest and whence we pray to rise. So a very beautiful idea of the resurrection. One day, just everything's going to fly open and we're all going to walk up on the earth again. It's a beautiful thought. But now, let me share with you his view of death years later. Long after, well, a few months after the Civil War had ended and all that death and destruction had been visited on the city, Henry Timrod was commissioned yet again by the cemetery to write a poem to celebrate the consecration of Magnolia Cemetery as the final holy resting place for the Confederate dead. And this is what he says. So this is addressed more to the Confederate dead than to the dead in general. Whose was the hand that... Oh, wrong one. Sleep sweetly in your humble graves, sleep martyrs of a fallen cause, though yet no marble column craves the pilgrim here to pause. In seeds of laurel in the earth, the garlands of your fame are sown, and somewhere waiting for its birth, the shaft is in the stone. Now those words always move me, but what a different view of death. And it's almost like, we know you are forgotten. We are here trying to pick up the pieces. People attending this consecration would have been lucky if they had eaten that day. They were so put down by the war and struggling during Reconstruction just to put food on their tables. But they showed up here that day to listen to Henry Timrod talk about a moment somewhere in time where these folks would be offered the proper praise that they deserved for their courage and their bravery. And again, I say this with no political agenda whatsoever. We're just talking about historical fact. Anyway, now having said all that, I want to conclude with this, but I have to take you to a different spot. I came across a beautiful story in a collection of Gullah stories written by John Bennett, published in the 1940s. It is a beautiful story, and it's based upon a Gullah story told by a Gullah man named Caesar Grant. And I want to just read it to you. It's not very long, if you'll bear with me. But first, my camera person, Joy, she's going to pan and just kind of let you enjoy the scenery as we make our way over to a different spot. So follow me. And we're on the bridge. And back in the day, in Victorian times, and well into the 20th century, there used to be paddle boats that you could rent, and you would go down that little set of steps there. You could paddle out here. This was a point of respite, of repose. This is where people came to tend gardens on tops of the graves of their loved ones. And as you walk through here, you realize that this was a place where people came to commiserate. And families would come here on the weekends and have picnics over the graves of their loved ones, and they would comfort each other. And of course, one of the things that people suffered back then was the loss of children during these outbreaks of yellow fever, typhoid fever, you name it, it swept through Charleston. And you get that when you walk through the cemetery, you see rows of children's graves and it breaks your heart. But back to the subject of resurrection. I'm gonna read this while Joy allows you to enjoy the beautiful scenery. And it's titled, All God's Chillin' Got Wings. Once all Africans could fly like birds, but owing to their many transgressions, their wings were taken away. There remained here and there in the sea islands and out of the way places in the low country, some who had been overlooked and had retained the power of flight, though they looked like other men. There was a cruel master on one of the sea islands who worked his people till they died. When they died, he bought others to take their places. These also he killed with overwork in the burning summer sun, through the middle hours of the day, although this was against the law. One day, when all the worn out enslaved people were dead of overwork, he bought of a broker in the town a company of native Africans just brought into the country and put them at once to work in the cotton field. He drove them hard. They went to work at sunrise and did not stop until dark. They were driven with unsparing harshness all day long, men, women, and children. There was no pause for rest during the unendurable heat of the midsummer noon, though trees were plenty and near. But through the hardest hours, when fair plantations gave their slaves rest, this man's driver, meaning slave driver, pushed the work along with a moment's stop for breath until all grew weak with heat
and thirst. There was among them one young woman who had lately borne a child. It was her first. She had not fully recovered from bearing and should not have been sent to the field until her strength had come back. She had her child with her, as the other women had, a straddle on her hip or piggyback. The baby cried. She spoke to quiet it. The driver could not understand her words. She took her breast with her hand and threw it over her shoulder that the child might suck and be content. Then she went back to chopping knot grass, but being very weak and sick with the great heat, she stumbled, slipped, and fell. The driver struck her with his lash until she rose and staggered on. She spoke to an old man near her, the oldest man of them all, tall and strong, with a forked beard. He replied, but the driver could not understand what they said. Their talk was strange to him. She returned to work, but in a little while she fell again. Again the driver lashed her until she got to her feet. Again she spoke to the old man, but he said, "Not yet, daughter, not yet." So she went on working, though she was very ill. Soon she stumbled and fell again, but when the driver came running with his lash to drive her on with her work, she turned to the old man and asked, "Is it time yet, Daddy?" He answered, "Yes, daughter, the time has come. Go, and peace be with you," and stretched out his arms toward her, so, like this. With that, she leaped straight up into the air and was gone like a bird, flying over field and wood. The driver and overseer ran after her as far as the edge of the field, but she was gone, high over their heads, over the fence, and over the top of the woods, gone, with her baby astraddle of her hip, sucking at her breast. Then the driver hurried the rest to make up for her loss, and the sun was very hot indeed, so hot that soon a man fell down. The overseer himself lashed him to his feet. As he got up from where he had fallen, the old man called to him in an unknown tongue. My grandfather told me the words that he said, but it was a long time ago, and I have forgotten them. But when he had spoken, the man turned and laughed at the overseer and leaped up into the air and was gone like a gull, flying over field and wood. Soon another man fell. The driver lashed him. He turned to the old man. The old man cried out to him and stretched out his arms as he had done for the other two. And he, like them, leaped up and was gone through the air, flying like a bird over field and wood. Then the overseer cried to the driver, and the master cried to them both, "Beat the old devil! He is the doer!" The overseer and the driver ran at the old man with lashes ready, and the master ran too, with a picket pulled from the fence, to beat the life out of the old man who had made those slaves fly. But the old man laughed in their faces and said something loudly to all the slaves in the field, the new slaves and the old slaves, and as he spoke to them, they all remembered what they had forgotten and recalled the power which once had been theirs. Then all the slaves, old and new, stood up together. The old man raised his hands, and they all leaped up into the air with a great shout. And in a moment, they were gone, flying like a flock of crows, over the field, over the fence, and over the top of the wood. And behind them flew the old man. The men went clapping their hands, and the women went singing. And those who had children gave them their breasts, and the children laughed and sucked as their mothers flew and were not afraid. The master, the overseer, and the driver looked after them as they flew, beyond the wood, beyond the river, miles on miles, until they passed beyond the last rim of the world and disappeared in the sky like a handful of leaves. They were never seen again. Where they went, I do not know. I never was told. Nor what it was that the old man said that I have forgotten. But as he went over the last fence, he made a sign in the master's face and cried, "Kuliba, Kuliba!" I don't know what that means, but if I could only find the old wood sawyer, he could tell you more, for he was there at the time and saw the Africans fly away with their women and children. He is an old man, over 90 years of age, and remembers a great many strange things. As told by Caesar Grant of John's Island, a carter and a laborer who relayed this story to John Bennett. It appeared in this book, which I highly recommend. Anyway,
I know it went for a while. I hope you enjoyed it. I think we all love being read to. I remember when I was a kid, every afternoon my sister and I would get in front of the TV, the black and white TV, and we would watch a program on South Carolina ETV run by a woman who called herself Ladybug. And she had a group of kids with her, and she'd look into the screen of the TV and she'd say, "How you Junebugs out there in Junebug land?" And I hope that I've done her proud, because she used to read on her show and we used to love to listen. All right, I'm going to let you go. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed it. And again, we're going to have other videos coming up every afternoon at 2 o'clock. And again, we love that you're tuning in, and we will, just like I said, we love doing it as much as you love watching. Anyway, namaste, y'all. Be good, be safe, and we'll see you soon. Bye-bye.